Welcome to the Holy Atheist Church, and thank you for joining me with all your brothers and sisters gathered here today. Listen closely, and you will hear another uplifting talk by your Right Reverend Divine. Tonight, I'm going to explain why God didn't do it right the first time. There's a story told about a man long past his prime, with hair that was going white. However, he still managed to walk into a jewelry store one Friday evening with a gorgeous young girl at his side. "Can I be of service?" said the jeweler with the silky voice. "Yes," the old man said. "I would like to buy something very special for my lady." "I think I know just what you want," said the jeweler. He quickly looked through his stock and he pulled out a beautiful ring in an exquisite box. Price tag said $5,000. The old man shook his head. "No," he said. "I'd like to see something even more special. Let me put it to you. Is she not worthy of more?" Suddenly, the jeweler got a glint in his eye as he saw that a big sale was on the table. He opened his safe, where he kept all his very best stock, and the ring he produced was fit for a goddess. "Perhaps this is what you're looking for," purred the jeweler. "It is $40,000 and would look divine upon this beautiful woman's finger." The young lady's eyes flashed with delight as she visibly trembled. Her smile was dazzling. The old man saw her eagerness, and he said, "I'll take it." The girl inhaled sharply. "And how will you be paying for this?" asked the jeweler. "I'll write you a check," replied the old man. "We will be by to pick up the ring once the check clears on Monday afternoon." Monday morning, the old man received a frantic phone call. "Sir," said the jeweler angrily, "your check was worthless. There was no money in your account." "I am very sorry," said the old man. "I know the check was worthless. However, let me tell you about my weekend." This story tells us something about planning ahead. When you have a particular goal in mind, you work out what it will take to bring it to pass. As thinking creatures, we understand this. In Genesis 1 and 2, we read about another plan. This time it was God who took a crack at pulling it off. However, as we see, God wasn't as effective as the old man. In Genesis 1:26, we read that God made man and woman and set them as rulers over creation. In Genesis 1:28, God commanded Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply. In Genesis 2, things are revisited, covering the same ground from chapter 1, however, in a different way. It begins by finishing off with day 7 of the creation story, and then goes back to how man came to be. It describes how God made Adam from the dust of the ground and breathed into him, which brought the dirt to life. God was already winging it because in Genesis 2:15, he had made a garden and put Adam into the garden all by himself. Then, in verse 18, God figures out that it was not good for man to be alone. He then yanked a rib out of Adam for some reason and built the first woman from it. It sounds like he was already winging it because Adam was walking around the garden and had been told about the tree he wasn't supposed to eat from and had been assigned some tasks before God figured out that man needed a woman. Adam not only would get lonely by himself, but he would have had a tough time trying to be fruitful and multiply without a girl. But fortunately, God came up with a corrective plan after the fact. And it looked like things were going to work out okay. In recap, the story tells us that God planned to create man, and he even fixed him up with a hot woman, and they were both living in paradise for all eternity. The plan was a little iffy, because they were running around naked, but they didn't see the significance of that. Perhaps in that state, being fruitful and multiplying might still be a problem. But maybe not. It doesn't go into that. So, God has kicked off his plan. Everything is moving forward. And since it was God's plan at work, what could possibly go wrong? Everything. They grabbed some of the fruit from the wrong tree, and here we are. If only God could have planned as well as the old man did for that awesome weekend. But he couldn't, or at least he didn't. Things went south on God, and he had to come up with a plan B. In this plan, God would kill himself so he could save us all. And now we will be saved and put into paradise, once we are perfected. Maybe if he'd created that old man in the jewelry store first, the guy could have pointed out the flaws in what God was doing. Now, I know what you are thinking, dear brothers and sisters. You are asking yourself, if the far simpler and easier plan failed to work, Why will the second convoluted, illogical plan do any better? We just have to take God at His word. He promised us in Ezekiel 11, 19, and 20 that He now has an answer to the flawed gift of free will. He says, I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my rules and obey them. How did they get hearts of stone in the first place is another question, but here we see that all that sinful stuff will be forcibly removed and people will be able to toss out their natures and their free will and be able to follow God's odd and confusing rules. We will be all set. God will reach in and exchange the bad sinful heart and put in a good sinless heart that will wish to do good. Do you suppose that Adam had a stony heart at the start? Perhaps, along with the dirt God used, a stone snuck in and migrated to where the heart of flesh should have been. That would explain it, perhaps. Then, in Jeremiah 32:40, it says, I will make them an everlasting covenant, that I will not turn away from doing good to them, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts, that they may not turn from me. We see here that God will turn into a boogeyman and scare the people into being good, because there will be fear in the hearts of the saved, so they will be unable to sin anymore. I have met many Christians who are terrified of hell. Do you suppose that is what he meant by fear? Or perhaps they are afraid because they know what kind of monster it would take to torture sentient people for all eternity. That would make sense. But wait, you might ask, what about free will? Clearly we can see from these verses that it has been completely overrated all along, and none of this mess was ever necessary, if God had only done it right the first time. Free will to sin won't exist in the future new world that God will set up. And so the only sin that will be going on will be the cursing from the burning fires as the wicked, you know, the ones who use their free will to choose to do something that God didn't like, are perpetually turned on the holy spit over the flames. It is described in Revelation 21:8, where it tells us, but the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magical arts, and the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. But all the righteous will be topside, laughing and partying, celebrating the fact that the evil are being punished, while these righteous are safe from that, and instead are stuck praising the bumbling fool who let it all happen. Pretty cool, huh? You too now can have fear in your hearts, and will therefore choose to do the right thing, just like it says in Jeremiah. There will be a reset done, as described in Revelation 21, where there is a new heaven and a new earth made just for the righteous, where God will come down to dwell right with them. However, apparently the delight of swimming in the ocean is going to be left out. Perhaps God doesn't like bikinis. Just look at verses 1 to 8, where it says, Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among men, and He will dwell with them. They will be His people, and God Himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all of this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magical arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. So, brothers and sisters, what does this tell us? Aside from upgrading the actual material to be consumed as the mechanism for creating eternal life, from a tree in the Garden of Eden to a spring of water, hey, maybe it's the fountain of youth sought by Ponce de Leon. We read that there will be a time in the future when God finally gets it right and wipes out all sin for good and makes it impossible for man to ever sin again. I'm thinking that Rube Goldberg would have really been on the same page with God here. In the Garden of Eden, there were just two people involved and one talking snake. Even a juggler can easily handle three things in the air at once, but not God. However, in the climax of the story, at the end of the book, we read that he has progressed so far that he can perfectly control a complex, illogical, absurd plan, which includes so many incomprehensible twists and turns that it forms a Gordian knot, which is tied together through the choices made by millions of people. God apparently started out very weak in his planning stage, but he can be trained, and he is finishing strong. Please ignore Hebrews 13:8, where it says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. In Numbers 23:19, it says, God is not man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should change his mind. Has he said, and will he not do it? Or has he spoken, and will he not fulfill it? We get a mixed message here. God never changes, including his mind, and yet, okay, he regretted making man and wiped him out with a flood. He loves us, but can't help but torture us forever if we screw up. I guess in the book of heaven it is written that this is what a loving father does. Since non-believers are included in the list of people writhing in pain in the lake of fire, all I can tell you, brothers and sisters, is that we are very fortunate indeed that we can ignore all evidence, reason, and logic, and instead rely on faith exclusively. That allows us to still believe with all our hearts when everything says that this is a stupid choice. Do I hear an amen? We can safely ignore the atheist, that poor misguided soul, who it is said is heading for the lake of fire, when he asks us, well, why didn't God do it the same way in the first place as he says he will do it in the end? Obviously, free will is wiped out, and he will force man to be good from that day forward, ensuring that sin will not return. If he had done that with Adam and Eve, then no one would be burning in the lake of fire. I hear you, brothers and sisters. You are murmuring in your pews. You wonder what possible answer there might be to this question that appears to have no answer. Be not deceived. We have a weapon far more powerful than logic and reason. We have our faith. We have the assurances of God's holy word, no matter how contradictory or absurd it may sound, and it will comfort us. In the final analysis, we must remember Psalms 14:1. Let its words comfort you and lay all questions to rest. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that doeth good. Maybe God appears to be illogical and stupid, but we know it would be foolish to think that he is not actually there. All questions atheists might raise or arguments they might make will fall into the dust and be treated as though they are of no account. God chose to screw it up the first time to demonstrate his love and his ability to find bloody and sick ways to fix problems. If it were simple and straightforward and easy to understand, it couldn't have come from God. For example, just think of those thousands of years of Christians staring at that nasty statue of Jesus hanging dead on the cross. For many children, it is one of their first horrible memories. They look up at that scene of torture and misery, and irrationally are told that this is the ultimate symbol of God's love and salvation. If God had made Adam and Eve, like the people will be in heaven, we would have missed out on all of that. But if that had happened, we never could have truly known the depth of God's love for us. Do I hear an amen? God, if he is God, could have done it right the first time. We know this by definition. He knows all things. He sees the end from the beginning. And so it is a fact, based upon our unwavering faith, that he, in fact, chose not to do it right. Who among you can question the infinite goodness and the love of our mighty Creator? We have our faith. In Hebrews 11:1, it tells us, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. As it says, we need not see. We only hope that all this is true, but that is enough. For did not Jesus tell Thomas in John 20:29, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Thomas demanded proof, but he was condemned for not being gullible at first. To this very day, the pejorative label, doubting Thomas, is applied to people who don't believe. We are much better than he was, for our faith is not based on seeing. It is not based on evidence. We simply believe. Poor, foolish Thomas had to have proof, like one of these silly atheists. We know with great certainty that even when God is wrong, we can trust his wisdom. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, indeed, even when he does the absolutely wrong thing, it is found to be the right thing. Logic is confounded, reason is thwarted, and evidence is deprecated to the point of non-existence. In fact, we are left without any evidence at all that God even exists, but we have His word in our hearts as we hold His book in our hands. And therefore, we know we are safe in the bosom of the Lord. We know for a fact, based entirely upon the Bible's testimony, that God didn't do it right in the Garden of Eden, for He failed in His purpose. However, we also know that He is infallible, so we cannot question His actions. Brothers and sisters, do not sin. Do not walk the dark paths of skepticism. Set aside your desire for evidence, for it doesn't exist. Put down your foolish attempts to reason with logic. God is there. God is good. And we will all be saved by His love. It's in the book. I'd like to thank you, brothers and sisters, for joining me today. And don't forget, on your way out, that it takes money to spread this message of love. And I ask that you show your devotion by filling the collection buckets at the door. I will see you next week.